Okay guys, until this part we have studied the process of cell division which give rise to morula phase from the zygote. So zygote was a cell with 2n number of chromosome, and then start dividing and it produces a mass of cell added attached one after another, just like a tumor condition, like the tumor cells, and they aggregate together, right, to make a solid mass of cell. Now that solid mass of cell is then modified. See, this is the cell, these are the cells that are arranged together, solid mass of cell. Then those cells start to arrange in the periphery, creating a small pore in the middle, which is a hollow, forming a hollow sphere in the middle. This phase is called as a blastula, remember, blastula. And the cells that are surrounding the periphery, those cells of blastula are termed as blastomere, and thus those pore inside is the, so if I go here, it is clear. If you see here, it's something like this. See, this is the phase of morula where cell divide one after another and stack itself one upon another. But in blastula, those cells are much more organized in the periphery only. So those cells of blastula are termed as blastomere, right? And the sphere that is formed, the pore that is formed in the middle, the fluid filled cavity or space that is formed is known as blastocell. These are the two terminologies, right? So morula is a ball of cells, blastula is a hollow sphere of cells. Now the question is, once the blastula is formed, this is the phase where cells are organized. After the blastula is formed, then the cell will undergo the determination, because each cell has a particular fate, right? That cell will produce a type of cell as the embryo will mature into organism. Some cell will destined to produce neuron, some cell will destined to produce the liver cell, some cell will destined to produce the muscle cell. So once that determination is reached, then the important task for generation of the different tissues and cells, and this process is known as differentiation phase or gastrulation phase. Now during this phase, the fate of the cell is already determined. Now the cell will undergo some changes, some physiological changes, and the gene expressive changes will ultimately lead to the generation of the distant specific structure of the organism. So during that point, during the point of cell division in morula as well as in blastula, we have seen the cell division to occur rapidly, very, very fast. But in this case, once they are restored to the formation of gastrula or gastrula phase, where they want to produce a specific organ structure, in that case, those cells should come back to the normal cell cycle or normal mode of cell cycle. Remember, during the morula and blastula phase, in midpoint of the blastula, the cell cycle that they undergo is contain only two different phase. One is M phase or mitotic phase, another one is S phase. So S phase, synthesis of DNA occurs and synthesis of cyclin occurs. Then in M phase, cell division passes by. So they bypasses the growth phases, G1 and G2 phase, completely during the process of morula as well as the midpoint of blastula. But after the blastula is reached at the middle, so the midpoint of blastula, that's called the mid blastula, when those cells are containing the code for the determination to convert into a specific organ, at that time those cell should convert its cell division cycle again into normal. So this is a mode of normal cell division where we have a G1 phase larger, S phase of synthesis, a growth 2 or G2 phase larger time, and then the mitotic phase. So in this case, they should shift back to the normal, and this shifting is called the mid blastula transition. While the cell is entering the embryo, a cell division entering from blastula to gastrulation. So see, during this process they will involve multiple cyclins, not the only cyclin B that was taken care during the morula and blastula. So here we have cyclin B, along with we have cyclin D, we have cyclin E, cyclin A, all of the cyclins playing the role. So in this case, embryo start transcribing its own RNA. This is a time, right? And cells start moving around in preparation for the gastrulation. So that is the phase that they will follow. So what determines this mid-blastula transition? The mid-blastula transition is hugely dependent on the nucleus to cytoplasm ratio or NC ratio. Now remember, at the beginning of the cleavage, that is the pre-cleavage time where the zygote is formed and no cleavage is done. In that case, we have one nucleus. And let's say that zygote after 4 cell division will produce 16 cell. So that zygote we see the 16 cells that zygote will produce by transferring its cytoplasmic content. So here we have only one nucleus and capacity to produce 16 different cell. So if we see the value is 0.06, which is kind of close to zero. So the nucleus is to cytoplasm ratio is close to zero. But on the other hand, if you look at here in case of gastrulation, the cell division process, after 4 cell divisions, the number of nucleus becomes 16, as well as the number of cells that are generated also becomes 16. So the number comes like 1 close to 1. So this is the idea. The nucleus is to cytoplasmic ratio at the pre-cleavage condition was close to zero. But now after this process, after the mid transition, mid-blastula condition, mid-blastula transition phase, it will become close to 1. So from 0 to close to 1. This is the ratio of nucleus is to cytoplasm, which determines whether the mid-blastula transition will occur or not. So we have already talked about the embryonic stages of blastula like that, right? So now let's talk about another important fact. Say here, look at here, this point at the morula phase, where all those cells are stacked upon one another. And I've told you earlier also, those cells should interact properly with themselves, right? And the interaction here is cell-cell interaction. The cell surface receptors are present. With the help of those cell surface receptor, mostly proteoglycans, they interact with themselves. Now this cell-cell interaction is very important because at this point, those cells should be placed together like a formation of a mass of cells or wall, because we don't want those cells to be separated from each other. So why those cells aggregated with each other? The reason behind that is a cell adhesion molecules, right? That influences the blastula organization. The cell adhesion molecules are also known as CAMs, right? These are transmembrane cell surface proteins that binds to the CAMs of another cell. So one cell have a kind of CAM, another cell, let's draw it with another color. So this is another cell have another CAM. With the help of these CAMs, those two cell can interact with itself in the surface level, and that interaction is required. So CAMs are involved in cell migration as well as producing stable tissue structure. That is also very, very important. The experiments have shown that cadherins is one type of CAM, and cadherins plays a very vital role for the stabilization of all those cells and interactions of all those cells. Like say one type of CAM, cadherin is one type of CAM which stabilizes the frog blastula we see. Now there are different types of cadherins that are found in the surface of cells. There are E cadherins, there are P cadherins, and many more type. Now in case of frog blastula, the E cadherin plays a vital role of interaction. A cadherin that is present outside the cell can interact with the nearby cell. This is the image. So say this is a control embryo where you see those cadherins are playing a vital role. Cadherins are okay, they are prepared, they are interacting with themselves, and the cells are tightly packed with each other together, creating this hollow sphere in middle. This is the blastocoel, right? But here, let's say by some mutation, if we take out all the cadherin out of the place, or all the this is the cadherin taking out condition where there is no cadherin present. So see, blastula formation halted and blastula formation is prevented because that idea of spreading cells to the periphery, creating a pore in the middle, and arranging all the cells tightly to control that region where the blastocoel will be there is lost when the cadherins are gone. So cadherins play a vital role, and in different experiments it is proven. For example, in this beautiful picture it is illustrated. a sudden change in cell adhesion occurs in the 8-cell embryo, and in this condition we have an uncompacted structure of the embryo. So all of the cells start dividing, and once they divide, they are attached with one after another to form this kind of structure, right? But normally in blastula or gastrula phases, we see the structure like this. See, by looking at the structure, it's barely impossible to tell how many cells are present there, because all the cells are merged with one another, but their membranes are not merged though. Their membranes are separate, and they are separate cells, but the interaction between the cells are so beautiful that they are interacting and forming a one unique kind of structure like that, more compact structure. So see, same 8-8 cell here as well as here in two different embryos, but see, in this case it is more compact and more position effective, because more space effective model, because in this case it occupies more space, but in this case it occupies less space. So that's another important thing. The space is a matter, and in that case many cells to be stored. So this is the way they do this. Another very good example here. These are all real life, real time pictures. They are not schematics. So see here, this is another case where we see embryos. Here the embryo with cadherins and all these things, right? Cadherins are present. So see, all the embryos kind of attached. By looking at here from the top view, we can say in this disease that the cells are, these are kind of one cell, like it looks like a one cell, right? As you can see, looks like one cell. We're looking at a giant cell, but actually in reality multiple cells are there, 8 cells are there. They are arranged one after another in this beautiful way of cadherin interaction. On the other hand, if you see here, this E cadherin plays a role in this particular case. So in the second case, what we do, we treat this embryos with antibodies that are blocking the E cadherin, because see, this is a cell and there are E cadherin receptors. So if I design an antibody that will block this E cadherin receptor, so in no way that this cell can interact with the nearby cell with cadherin. So as a result, blocking this cadherin with the antibodies, anti-cadherin antibodies, we will see structures like that, where we can easily distinguish the cells. You can see 8 cells can be easily distinguished in all those plates, and they are looking like the cells are separated, but in this case all the cells are working together as a unit. So that's what a cell want, that's what an embryo want during the embryogenesis. So once we talk about all the stuff, we started with the 2n number of cells, which is a zygote. Remember, we start with a zygote. That zygote then have rapid cell division. Rapid division. After the rapid division, it produces what we call morula, the morula phase. Then that morula, those cells, those ball of cells start to arrange properly. And what they form is called as a blastula. Blastula, where the cells are called blastomere, and it is a hollow sphere of cells, which is a spore in the middle, which is called blastocele, right? And this is blastula. So we are, let's write it morula. So we begin from zygote, then we have our journey through morula to blastula. So from blastula, we've seen that nucleus is to cytoplasm ratio play a vital role in determining whether the blastula, those embryo will ultimately turn and itself into the gastrulation phase. So once the gastrulation phase is reached, then the blastula will modify itself. The gastrulation starts while the blastula slowly starts to have invagination of cells, or furrowing, cleaving of cells, because all the cells that are forming this hollow sphere slowly start to invaginate inside. So whatever cell region that are present outside slowly start to invaginate inside, and that's called the gastrula. Actually, the idea of gastrulation is to provide three different layers of cells, ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm, right? Ectoderm is the content of cell that presents at the outermost side, endoderm the content of cell that is present innermost side, and mesoderm is the cell layer that is present in between the ectoderm and endoderm section. So this is the beauty of gastrulation. While during the gastrulation, even before the gastrulation, the cells of blastula even know what kind of cell and organ they want to produce. So their fate are already determined there. So once their fate are determined, then those blastula cells will undergo this gastrulation phase, where the folding of cells occur. And this is important stuff, where, you know, up till this blastula phase, we see the cell division playing a vital role, as well as in the blastula, we see cell-cell interaction using the surface receptor molecules or cadherin molecules play a vital role. But after the blastula, while we are talking about gastrulation, we will see the cell migration playing a vital role. Those cells will slowly start to migrate, right? Slowly start to migrate and creating folds in the blastula holosphere. As a result, it generates three different layers. One, it generates three different layers, and from each of the layer, different organs will start to generate. From ectoderm, it usually produces skin. It produces neural or nervous system. From mesoderm, it produces digestive system. From endoderm, it produces digestive system and respiratory system. From mesoderm, it produces muscle system as well as a blood vessel system. So see, all those different types of different layers produce different type of cells and organ system in our body. So see, we'll see different gastrulations. This is the gastrulation of sea urchin. See, this is the situation of blastula, right? So this is a blastula phase of cells, where you can see the peripheral cell and a blastocele in the middle. These are the blastomeres. And in any embryo, there are two different options. One is the animal hemisphere and vegetal hemisphere. Animal pole and vegetal pole. Now remember, the gastrulation means the folding of those blastula cells like a sheet and generating three different layers. The gastrulation phase always works from the vegetal pole. Gastrulation always works from the vegetal pole. Remember, for an embryogenesis, the cleavage always starts from the animal pole where there is less yolk content. But gastrulation always starts from the vegetal pole. So here, see, gastrulation, these vegetal pore cells are normal, in the normal condition. Now these cells slowly start to migrate towards the blastocele region. So as they slowly start to migrate, they start to create a pore here that is called a blastopore. And then it's pushing itself inside. Invagination start to form inside. And as it is forming the invagination, that blastopore slowly start to increase its condition. And then they create three different layers properly after the movement. Because see, the migration of cell occurs in from the both direction like that, and then they will meet with each other. So see, in middle, we have now colored coded it with the yellow, because this is a completely different inner tissue now, and there is a pore outside, and in between there is a section of hollow chamber which is squeezed and forming a structure like this. Okay, so see, at this point, this is the endoderm. This is the endoderm structure that is formed, and the blastopore remains there. The blastopore that is present here, this blastopore will ultimately produce either mouth or anus, depending upon the organism we are dealing with. And then that cavity that is generated due to the invagination of those cells, that cavity, this is the cavity, remember, in between. This cavity is known as archenteron, and this archenteron will finally fold, and archenteron is will ultimately produce what we know as a primitive gut of that organism. And this is the ectoderm, outermost layer. The ectoderm provides us nervous system as well as skin. Endoderm, this is the yellow layer. It creates the linings of digestive and respiratory tracts. And this archenteron produces primitive gut. Mesoderm was not shown here, but actually, this is the mesodermal region. So the mesodermal region, it produces the blood vessel, muscle, bone, liver, and heart. So see, these are the embryonic stages for the gastrulation phase. It's not very difficult, though many students find it difficult, but actually it's very easy. It's simple. Imagine a hollow sphere of balls, and imagine those blastomeres, all those cells slowly start to migrate to create the cavity in between. This is the image again. So see, these are the blastopores start to form from here. Cells start migrating, and they are creating the blastula phase. During the gastrula phase, microtubule dynamics plays a vital role, because it's all about migration of cells, right? So in any cases, migration of cells require microfilaments, microtubules and actin filaments to work properly. So see, this is the ectoderm that is present, and once it slowly start to create the vagination, in that case all those cells slowly start to stretch itself, creating a larger, longer, thinner cells like that. And see, the microtubules, previously normal cells arranged haphazardly like any place like that. But after that, while the cells are destined to produce this invagination, those microtubules start to arrange itself in stretched long condition to create thinner and larger cells, longer cells. And those microtubules then slowly arrange itself, they will squeeze the cell up, and then they create this invagination. And this invagination, you'll see from the dorsal to the ventral view for the cells. Well, all the nucleus present at one point, the ventral point of the cell, and the microtubules are creating the thin cell lines there. Now, if you look at the gastrulation of frog, it becomes much more clear, because in gastrulation frog, again, this is a blastula phase with the animal pole and vegetal pole. See, vegetal pole contains all those components, right? All the yolk components there. And here at the middle of there are three different lineage of cells that are already being formed. We could have told you that before gastrulation, cells already get their code for the determination. That means what kind of cell they want to produce, what kind of organs they want to produce. So see here, the joint between this blue and this cell, there is a red colored cells, as well as there's a small pore in between from where the invagination start. We call it a dorsal lip of blastopore. The lip of blastopore, and this dorsal lip of blastopore, that joint of the dorsal lip of blastopore contains some stretchy cells called as bottle cells. Actually, the bottle cell guide the whole process of invagination process, and it's very easy to find the migration of cells by staining the bottle cells, because bottle cell migrates forward direction as the invagination slowly start to occur at this direction. So if we stain bottle cells, we can see the migration. So see, slowly these cells start to migrate, and the blastopore slowly start to engulf, and there is a cavity start to form. See, this is a small thinner cavity. It will become larger eventually. So this is the involution that start to occur, and slowly they start to form that archenteron or primitive gut. Remember, the same thing in case of sea urchin, we see the archenteron form straight forward. Here also we see with the help of a blastopore at the terminal, and this is the lip. Dorsal lip means a portion which closes the terminal or closes the blastopore and opens the blastopore. It's a small tissue. So that is the dorsal lip. So here, this archenteron that is formed due to the migration of cells will form the primitive gut again. But see, the migration of cells are in this direction. This is the arrow, right? Migration is in this direction. So here, but these cells that are present in the joint will migrate to the bottom. These all cells will migrate to the top, which is a anti-clockwise direction in this case. But all the other cells that are present on the top, the ectodermal cells, that will migrate to the opposite direction. Okay, so see, the inner cells, they migrate. The inner tissue, that is the movement start, it will migrate to anti-clockwise. But the outer tissue, that is the blastomere cells, they will migrate to the opposite clockwise direction, right? As a result, what they will form, they will bring itself down, and this pore that was previously there, the blastocele content, which will be fused properly at the end, and that blank region, that small hole region that is there, which will be blocked by a process called yolk plug, right? And rest is only archenteron that is formed. Rest of this blastocelic portion will be sealed with the yolk plug. Remember, this is a unique feature for frog gastrulation, which we haven't seen in case of sea urchin gastrulation, because in this case, that blastocele section, as this part moving closer, as well as this is moving closer, they will fuse with each other, and that blastocele portion is gone now. We only have whatever content remain, we only have with the archenteron. We only have with the archenteron, and that will form primitive gut. So now if you look at the gastrulation in chick or chicken embryo, what we process, because chicken embryo division is quite different than that of the frog gastrulation, because in chick we know the blastula is not that much, I mean, formed not that much, because the cell division that start to form in chick from the animal poll, if you see, there are incomplete cleavage that start to form. Incomplete cleavage. So this is a cell from the top view. If you look, this is an animal poll top view. Cleavage occurs, start like that, and after that second cleavage like that. So see, the cleavage is not complete in case of the chicken embryo. So the cleavage occurs in the middle, and cleavage occurs sometimes. So this incomplete cleavage that occurs during the cheek cleavage process or cell division process, and then it forms a modula, then blastula and all this stuff. So whatever thing is formed, it contains all these regions that are present. See, this is the structure, the cross section that is showing us the process. So see here, these are the this is the blastomere, the blastomere cells that are present here, right? And here are the blastocele content, right? This is the blastocele content, and yolk is present here, right? And if you look at here, there are the already tissue that are being generated, which is the endoderm. This is the section of endoderm, and these are called the hypoblast and epiblast. Whatever cells present at the top, in case of chicken, we call them epiblast. AP means in the top, and whatever cells present in the bottom region, we call them hypoblast. So the idea here, again, in case of chicken, the process of gastrulation is related with the development of neurons. The neural development is tallied with the gastrulation phase, where the neural node that is formed due to the cleavage, the neural node forms. See, this is the neural node, which you call as a primitive streak. The primitive streak means small fold originates on the top of the embryo, and that from that fold, see, the arrows that are denoted are the migration direction for the cells. So all the surrounding cells, they migrate to the bottom like this, the bottom region like that. So if this is the surface, just imagine this is the surface, and this cell slowly start to invaginate, create this invagination, and slowly start to go the bottom like that. So what it creates a V-shape like structures, an invagination there. That's what's formed here in the primitive streak, right? So see the cells migrating in this direction, and all the cells are migrating towards, some of the cells are migrating towards endoderm, some of them migrating towards the periphery. So some of the cells which are migrating towards the bottom will contain and attach to the endoderm cells and convert itself into the endodermal cells.